sharks are very widespread throughout the world. Unfortunately, very much threatened these days as well. They do face some huge challenges, but sharks have been around almost forever. They actually precede the dinosaurs. So they have actually, in many cases, they're thought of as rather primitive animals because they have been around for so long. But I prefer to think that it's they have evolved to the point where they don't really need to evolve any further. In many ways, you could say that they are perfectly designed for what they do. And there's a tremendous variety of sharks, and I'd like to include rays in that as well, because rays and sharks are very closely related and in many ways can be considered the same group of animals. But they're a very diverse group of animals. They vary widely in terms of appearance and habitats and habits and so on. And in many cases, they're not animals that typically come to mind. While they are ancient animals, again, they are also highly evolved, and in many cases, very specifically adapted to their particular niche in life. And I will have time for questions at the end. But in the case of rays, many of them are bottom dwellers, so they've evolved special mechanisms that enable them to breathe while laying on the bottom, like spiracles or gill openings on top of their head, and their eyes kind of raised up sort of like periscopes, so they can see what's going on while maintaining a very low profile. Pretty much all sharks and rays are very effective predators, and one of the things that makes them so is their exceptional sensory capabilities. And one of their really unique features is a whole series of electrical sensors located under their noses called the ampullae of Lorenzini. And they may not be obvious here because they're quite small, because this isn't going to work, but just between their nostrils, a series of pores that are very sensitive to electrical stimuli. They can actually use those to detect the very minute electrical fields of their prey. Like all top predators, sharks are a vital component of healthy ecosystems. And of course, it goes on land as well, but there have been many cases where it's become very apparent that if the top predators are removed from the environment, the entire environment as a whole suffers. So they really are not only inspiring animals, but they're very important for maintaining a healthy balance of nature. And in fact, studies have shown without a doubt that reefs that have healthy populations of sharks tend to have healthy fish populations as well, and actually have more fish rather than less, which might be counterintuitive because sharks do feed on a lot of fish, but in doing so, they perform a very important job in controlling sick and diseased and genetically weak individuals, and therefore increase the health of the ecosystem as a whole. And largely to media hype and probably the movie Jaws more than anything else, this is the image that comes to mind for many of us when we think about sharks. And yes, great white sharks are out there. They are one of many, many species, but they're not exactly typical sharks. And I think they are amazing and beautiful animals in their own right. But again, far from, if there is such thing as a typical shark, there are many, many more species that we don't necessarily think of that are much more typical of sharks and rays. Most sharks have neither the size nor the inclination to bother humans. The vast majority of sharks, at current estimates, are somewhere around 500 different species of sharks. The vast majority are quite small. In many cases, couldn't even get their mouths around any part of a human, nor would they be the least bit interested in doing so. And I think for many of us divers, that's one of the things that makes diving with sharks so interesting, is not only that they are such beautiful and inspiring animals, but they do come in such a wide variety, including many that are extremely graceful swimmers, like the silver shark, so Port Jackson sharks, which are very similar to the California horn shark, spiny dogfish shark. This is one of Chris's many amazing shots in the chilly waters of the Pacific Northwest. And a very rare sight, sad to say, just because there are so many sharks in this photo, and that's something we're lucky to see even an individual shark in many cases. This one is a California species, the horn shark. And again, one of just many, many cute, harmless little sharks that aren't the least bit inclined to bother anyone. Thresher shark, something that's been at the top of my own personal photo wish list forever and ever, even just to see underwater. Obviously, an exotic looking animal. They are not commonly seen anywhere. In fact, although there are probably more of them here in Southern California than anywhere else in the world, I don't know of anywhere that they can be reliably seen underwater here. Probably only one dive site in the world that you can go and have a reasonable chance of seeing them is a tiny little seamount in the Philippines where they come up to be cleaned by a cleaner fish on top of the reef only at sunrise for about 20 minutes a day. Very shy, as you can see from their eye, very light sensitive. That's why you can only have a chance of seeing them right at sunrise. But sharks do inhabit just about every corner of the world, in oceans, and in some cases even estuaries, and in a few cases freshwater rivers as well, ranging from the tropics, like this Caribbean reef shark, to very cold waters, like Alaska, in this case salmon sharks. By the way, the salmon shark is a close relative of the perbeagle, which is one of five species that we're very much hoping will gain protection in this upcoming 2013 CITES convention. Even colder waters, waters you'll never see me in, the Arctic ice. Our friend and colleague Saul Gunnar, who contributed many of the most unusual shots of the exhibit, photographed this Greenland shark under the Arctic ice. As well as this shot, this is one of the largest of all fish, in fact, second largest of all fish. It's a basking shark. They can grow to be lengths of 30, even 35 feet, and yet they're completely harmless. Feed on plankton, just around like a big vacuum cleaner, just filtering plankton out of the seawater. And the largest of all fish, the whale shark. They can grow to be the size of a school bus, 40 feet or more in length, weighing up to 20 tons, but again, completely harmless. Now, it would not be fair to say that sharks are never dangerous to humans. Certainly, many of them are potentially dangerous. Again, the vast majority would never go out of their way to hurt a person. But there is a legitimate danger there in some cases, but it's wise to keep that in perspective. First of all, out of the 500 something different species of sharks, only a few dozen that have ever been known to bite people, and of those, it really comes down to only three species that with any frequency to bite people. And even then, it's really very rare. But among those three species, let me just, first of all, you know, what comes to mind when we see a scene like this? Well, for a lot of the world, it's still a subject of terror. A shark, he must be out to get us. But as I kind of overheard Kevin say not long ago, again, sharks are not out to get us. Really, in almost all cases, sharks want nothing more than just to be left alone and go about their own business. Even those top three species that have been known to bite people, by and large, want nothing to do with us. But those are certainly sharks in general deserve our respect, and those three species in particular. The bull shark is one that certainly deserves respect, potentially quite dangerous. They are found throughout the world's oceans, but they prefer inshore areas. In fact, they're the only shark that regularly enters fresh water. They've been found in one case all the way, I think, almost 1,000 miles up the Mississippi River. And again, they're not looking for people to bite, but there's a chance because they have the same areas that we frequent that might. The tiger shark, probably number two on the list of those sharks that do bite people on some occasions. Certainly an animal not to be taken lightly. They're probably the least discriminating of all sharks in terms of what they eat. And that's also kind of a misconception. Most sharks are not mindless scavengers or mindless killers. They're actually, most of them are quite picky and specific about what they eat, but the tiger shark is perhaps the least specific, and therefore, again, one to be careful of. And of course, the great white shark. Now again, all three of these species have been known to bite people, but we are not on their menu. By and large, they want nothing more than to just go about their business and feed on their normal prey, which includes, in the case of great white sharks, sea lions, other fish, other sharks, not us. But one thing, of course, we all read from time to time about shark attacks that do happen. Why is this so? And it might even seem that they're seen as if they are on the increase. Well, statistically, that's not true. But we do, in our media-rich age, we do tend to hear about it more often. But bear in mind that nowadays there are more humans in the water than ever before in history. In spite of this, shark attacks are still very rare. If sharks wanted to eat people, they could do so every day of the year at hundreds of beaches around the world. So obviously, they're not out to get us. In the rare instances where sharks do choose to attack or end up attacking people, it's almost always a case of mistaken identity. And sharks don't necessarily have great eyesight. It depends a lot on the species. But especially in murky water, if people are swimming in areas that are frequented by the common prey of that species of sharks, and the case of a sea lion, can be easily mistaken, or say a sea turtle, for say a boogie boarder or a surfer. So I think you can see how not only sharks, but even humans can make a mistake like that in poor visibility and so on. So that's not to say that you're always safe in the water, but we do have a lot of control in terms of our own behavior. Obviously, avoid swimming in areas like sea lion rookeries or places that are frequented by sea turtles, especially at dawn and dusk, or swimming in the middle of school bay fish. Those are some things that we can do to reduce the chance of a shark attack. But again, the chances in any case are very, very slim. So it's certainly nothing to spend your time worrying about. We are far more in danger from regular mundane everyday things like driving to work in the morning and so on than being bitten by a shark. More people are killed each year by deer or bees than sharks. Now, there is a great deal of risk involved between sharks and humans, but it is actually the sharks that are very much in danger from us. And that's a sad reality these days. Roughly 30% of all shark species are threatened or near threatened with extinction. There are many more that very likely are, but we just can't prove that yet because the data is still insufficient. One of the reasons that sharks are so much endangered is that, unlike other fish, they are very slow to reproduce and to mature. Sharks are particularly vulnerable to overfishing. Unlike most fish that lay thousands of eggs, shark broods are often less than a dozen. In some cases, with the sandpiper shark here, only two pups born every several years. So reproducing so slowly, many of them don't reach sexual maturity until 10 or more years of age, and yet they're being caught at the same rate as fish that produce tens of thousands of eggs. So it's easy to see how they can quickly become endangered and threatened. That is especially true for the oceanic species, because they spend their entire life, like the silky shark, beyond the sight of land, in many cases beyond any kind of protections offered by governments in international waters. They're also very hard to monitor their population and assess just how endangered they are. Probably no more so than the oceanic white-tipped shark. And this is, I think, an especially poignant case. As recently as 1970, this species was considered the most populous large animal on the face of the earth. And yet, in just this brief amount of time between then and now, they are now hovering on the brink of extinction. According to a number of studies, depending on which population, at the very least, there's less than 30% of them remaining worldwide. The North Atlantic population is thought to be as few as 7% remaining. In the Gulf of Mexico, only 1%. And yet, they still do not have any official protection. It makes you wonder how much more endangered do they have to be considered an endangered species. This is one of the species, one of the five, that there's a special effort being made to have included on that endangered species list with the upcoming CITES convention. Let's hope that they're successful. Every year, more people are killed by toasters or vending machines than sharks. And yet, we don't vilify any of those things, so let's do try to keep it all in perspective. And by the way, a huge shout out here to Susie Foreman,
my friend Max,
and her friend Max the Nurse Shark, who's an old family friend. But Susie worked on a little board dive boat with me for many years, and very hardworking and talented underwater model, and certainly a longtime friend of sharks. Thanks, Susie. In fact, it is sharks that should be worried about humans, since roughly 2 million sharks are killed by humans for every person killed by a shark. And again, this is a photo that is typical of many sad endings for sharks, not always because of targeted efforts, but sometimes just accidental catches as well, which accounts for a lot of shark fatalities. I am happy to say in this particular case, this story had a happy ending. Actually, it was the three of us, Susie and Chris, and I happened to all be diving together in Thailand. Came across this zebra shark, which is among the species that are able to breathe even when they're stationary in the water, so it's still alive. And we spent our entire dive clipping it free from the entangling net, and it eventually swam away. Something to celebrate. The biggest problem, by far, as Kevin mentioned, of course, is the demand for shark fins to support the shark fin soup industry. And because the fins are so valuable, the fishermen typically remove the fins many times when the animal is still alive, and they just throw it overboard to suffer, in many cases, a painful death by starvation. certainly a very cruel practice, but also ecologically unsustainable. Fortunately, there has been significant good news lately on the shark conservation front, including right here in California. Within the last year, a law was passed prohibiting the harvesting or possession of shark fins anywhere in the state. And that's significant not only for sharks caught here in California, but especially as a trafficking point. And the hope is, of course, if similar laws can be passed elsewhere, that that will do a lot to control the shark fin trade. And similar efforts are being made on an international level, including many countries, the Maldives, Palau, Honduras, the Bahamas, all have set a great example in terms of actually outlawing shark fishing completely and totally protecting them. So huge steps in the right direction, and hopefully other countries will follow soon. Perhaps the best opportunity going forward to protect sharks is the upcoming CITES convention. That's coming up very soon, beginning of March in Bangkok, Thailand. They meet every two or three years. It's a gathering of many, many representatives of many countries that get together to decide what species are worthy of protection. And again, I think it should be clear by now, really there's many more species of sharks that should be on that list, but you have to kind of choose your battles. So for this upcoming convention, there are five species of sharks in particular, including the oceanic white tips, hammerheads, corbicles, spiny dogfish, all of which very much deserve protection, and hopefully we'll get it. In addition, manta rays, which are very much threatened, very slow to reproduce, and you just couldn't ask for more beautiful, graceful, harmless animals than manta rays, previously not sought after for food, and yet partly due to the overfishing of sharks, the shark fin industry selected them as kind of the next target, and basically drummed up this whole kind of myth of their use of traditional Chinese medicine to drive trade. They've been very successful in their marketing, and now there's a huge demand for manta rays, but not for the whole animal, just for their gill breakers. They kill these beautiful animals just for their gills to make up these potions. So again, I think there's probably never been a more worthy group of animals for protection. Another cause for encouragement is the fact that divers love to see sharks. And this has changed a lot in recent years. When I first started diving, most divers did not want to see sharks. They didn't really know whether it was safe or not, and most divers were just fine kind of doing without a shark encounter. But nowadays, and again, that's very much to the credit of the media in some cases, dispelling some of the myths about sharks. Most divers nowadays realize that sharks are not a threat to us and appreciate them for their beauty and are very keen to see them. And because of that, there's great potential for shark tourism. And this not only can further an appreciation for sharks, but it seems to always come down to economics. Nothing's really going to work until it makes economic sense. And there have been studies done that show that diving ecotourism really is a potential solution here, because divers want to pay to see sharks alive, and that is an ongoing renewable resource as opposed to killing a shark one time for its fins. In fact, several different studies have been done. In some cases, it's been shown a living shark may produce $1 million or more throughout its lifetime in diving tourism compared to maybe $100 if it's killed for its fins. So even for the people who don't appreciate the beauty and awe-inspiring qualities of sharks, almost everyone appreciates the economics of it. It makes more economic sense to keep sharks alive as an ecotourism draw than to kill them. So again, hopefully that word can get out, and mainland governments and organizations will take advantage of that. And I can tell you in this case, even the smallest shark is always a thrill and a pleasure to encounter underwater as a diver. For any of you who have the opportunity to swim with the world's largest fish, and once again, Susie here with the whale shark in Thailand, it really is a thrill of a lifetime. And hopefully the opportunities for encounters like that will continue into the future as we gain progress in terms of protecting these amazing animals. And with any luck, there will be sharks for us to show our children and grandchildren. So please do your part by spreading the word about shark conservation. Any of these online petitions certainly help. Again, fantastic organizations like Shark Savers who are out there fighting the good fight and getting the word out to make real changes. So please do your part to support these organizations and spread the good word about sharks. Thanks very much.